In chapter 9, Chaos and Chemistry, I look at both Sue, or In a Season of Crime, and Tis a Pity She Was a Whore, at the same time, folding these analyses into a larger philosophical exploration of chaos and its role in Bowie's creative practice, and the function that chaos serves on his last album. I'm only going to read a few sections of that chapter here, because I can't give everything away. So fair warning, this video essay ends abruptly without summarizing its conclusions. But hopefully the musicological unpicking of the song will be interesting to some of you. At its core, the musical style of Blackstar is a fusion of experimental rock and electronica, played with élan by improvising jazz musicians. It's a noticeable move away from the straight-ahead rock aesthetic that characterized the two preceding albums, The Next Day and Reality. The contrast in sound between Blackstar and Bowie's solidly established late style felt like an old-school style shift, those jolting, palate-cleansing changes he was known for making. For instance, between Hunky Dory and Ziggy, Never Let Me Down and Tin Machine, Earthling and Hours. Sometimes, hints and clues embedded in the last record can point in the direction of the next. The Next Day's finale, Heat, with its Scott Walker dry ice atmosphere and solemn yet tender modal colour, could arguably serve as a link, at least from the end of the album to the opening moments of Blackstar. However, more than a continuation of haunted atmospherics, Blackstar's new territory is distinguished by a tangible sense of barely tamed chaos, especially in the first half, textural intensity, a feeling of losing control, where the music itself seems on the edge of danger. The clues that Bowie was headed in that direction track back to the dark disorder of The Next Day's If You Can See Me, and were indicated with even more clarity in the collaboration with Maria Schneider and her jazz orchestra for the 2014 single version of Sue, or In a Season of Crime, and its surprising B-side, a home demo version of Blackstar's Tis a Pity She Was a Whore. Schneider and Bowie met and began working together in May 2014 after he and Tony Visconti went to see her and her band play at Birdland, a jazz club in Midtown Manhattan. Sue was developed in a collaborative spirit, with Schneider's input on the structure and thematic treatment earning her a co-writing credit. Paul Bateman and Bob Bamra, a production duo that had made drum and bass tracks under the name Plastic Soul, are also given a share of the songwriting credit. Sue interpolated the bassline of their composition, Brand New Heavy, from 1997, using it as its foundational rhythmic motif. And seemingly drawing further inspiration from its jungle breakbeat energy. That was no doubt a musical reference that Bowie, not Schneider, brought to the table, since we know Bowie was an avid follower of emerging dance music producers during the mid to late 1990s. Collaborative ideas were sketched out and workshopped live with the orchestra's rhythm section. Arrangements were tweaked and the whole lot was recorded in July at New York's Avatar Studios, these days once again known by its original name, Power Station Studios. The session was engineered by Kevin Killen, with Visconti co-producing. Schneider's ensemble for Sue included future Blackstar musicians Mark Juliana and Ben Monder on drums and guitar, respectively, and Donnie McCaslin on alto saxophone, one of the two primary soloists handpicked by Bowie, the other being Ryan Keberly on trombone. The song's churning, film noir-esque arrangement passes over its 7-minute-plus running time like a threatening weather system. With contrabass clarinet performed by Scott Robinson adding resonant sharpness to the low end like an edge of violence. Skittish drum patterns and syncopated bass, performed by Jay Anderson, are smoothed over by long sweeps of big band horns that surge past the ear, bending in pitch like an engine Doppler effect. Pressure builds through Lydian modal shifts between G and A over a G bass, increasing to crisis points that crash on E minor. The texture is always shape-shifting, coming and going, rising and falling, ridden by Bowie's central vocal, which is sometimes elongated and stretched across the sonic expanse. Other times focusing on a single note in rhythmic, almost liturgical recitative. Schneider directed the primary soloists, McCaslin and Keberly, to eschew traditional solo breaks in favour of a more constant improvisational decoration and commentary around Bowie's vocal. This meant that the players were reactively performing against Bowie for the duration of the song, filling the gaps with improvised gestures. In the end, Visconti and Bowie used McCaslin's take throughout, mixed side to right. With Keberly's solo featuring in the quieter transitional section that occurs in the 4th minute of the track, mixed slightly to the left. Goodbye. Sue or In a Season of Crime ended up winning in the category of Best Arrangement for Schneider at the 58th Annual Grammy Awards in 2016. Unreliable and ambiguous in the order of events it sets out, listeners are free to wonder if Sue is simply a cut-up confession from her killer, or the confused, one-sided fantasy of someone who was merely obsessed with her from afar. Is Sue of sound mind and body? The repeated use of her name, reminding her of where and who she is, telling her the results of her x-ray, seem vaguely infantilizing. On the other hand, the name being caressed repeatedly over that long Lydian angle calls to mind the romantic obsession of West Side Story's Maria.
Maria, 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 Maria. I've just met a girl named Maria, and suddenly that name will never be the same to me.
Sue constructs a blurred image of caregiving, obsession, and control, and by the end of the song, it's unclear whether a crime has taken place at all. Our erratic narrator describes pushing her body down beneath some weeds, but afterwards finds Sue's note, which informs him that she has left him for another man. It is up to the listener to decide if Sue managed to get away or not. The narrators of both Sue and Tis a Pity feel kin to the tyrants and tragic cases of the next day. Only now the stories have an element of comeuppance written in. The fresh musical approaches evident in both, the controlled squall of Sue and the rough and tumble of Tis a Pity, which we're going to look at next, by the way, foreshadow the sonic and musical tensions of Blackstar. It's significant that Bowie chose to revisit both pieces on Blackstar, the album. The two compositions share similarities in their lyrical perspectives, in the sense that both songs are sung by men who are left feeling stunned and slighted by their circumstances. And yet, the musical compositions achieve more than mere portrayals of these narratives, as the songs are animated with chaotic forces. In her book, Chaos, Territory, Art, Deleuze and the Framing of the Earth, Elizabeth Gross theorizes that the meaning of art springs from the intensities and sensations it inspires, not just from the artwork's original intention or the quality of its constituent elements, but in the way that it becomes expressive, to not just satisfy, but also to intensify, to resonate and become more than itself, merging with eternalizing or monumentalizing sensation. Art that stands apart from its creator, preserved in itself, a block of sensations. That's a quote from D&G, 1994. In the musical analysis of these pieces, we can consider evidence of the summoning of intensity and sensation, the calling forth of something new, flung out from the vortex. The version of Sue that appears on Blackstar as track 4 has a tempo of 170 beats per minute or 85 beats per minute, depending on how you choose to count it. The tonality is G major or G Lydian, and the song form is a very loose ternary of ABA. The harmonies at the core of Sue are deceptively simple, oscillating between two chords, G major and its relative E minor. However, the ways in which Bowie's arching, elongated melody sits against those harmonies generates drama, resolute tensions, and forward impetus. Sue is the last of Bowie's great Lydian melodies, a mode that he has employed on and off throughout the catalogue and, like Phrygian mode, used in the A section of Blackstar. It's relatively rare to find it in pop music, compared to, say, Dorian or Mixolydian. The Lydian scale is major with a sharpened fourth degree. Bowie uses it in compositions such as Vasawa from Low, Sons of the Silent Age from Heroes, Repetition from Lodger, Untitled Number 1 from The Buddha of Suburbia, Leon Takes Us Outside and The Heart's Filthy Lesson, both from One Outside. And Heat from The Next Day. My father and the prison. The mode affords us an eerie melodic angle, the tritone, throwing C-sharp on top of the G chord, the uncannily lifted note in the melody of I Got The Job. For Your Grave. The same tritone also drives the primary bass and guitar riff, the Diabolus in Musica interval that was once outlawed in the Renaissance period, its ambiguous and unsettled character deemed wholly inappropriate for music that should only express the grace and majesty of God. Naturally, or inevitably, this devil's interval became associated with heavy metal music, a trend attributed to pioneering band Black Sabbath and the opening hook of their debut single of the same name from 1970. In Sue, we are treated to some heavy tritone riffage from Munda, Lefebvre and Juliana that draws on that unsettling Diabolus power. This riff orients the track towards rock and away from the jazz band stylings of the Schneider arrangement, and Juliana's playing leans into a more aggressive, harder-edged breakbeat style. McCaslin was keen to find a hook that would differentiate the Blackstar arrangement of Sue from the previous one, which he felt held a definitive status. To do this, he found moments in the song form where he could push the playing intensity further.
Because the other version is so orchestral and so, you know, thick. Mm. So So we tried a couple different things with the song form, where we were essentially jamming on the first chord and David was singing, and now I cue the next chord. You know, we tried a few variations of that, and it just wasn't totally locking in. And I went back to the Maria version and essentially kind of did a condensed version with clarinets and flutes of some of the key lines. So the key point is that we went back kind of to that song form. And I was just playing saxophone and Jason on keys, and it just felt great. And this was one where we got to a certain point in the form and it just went kind of free. And there's the cue for that, if y'all listen again, is where David starts to sing Sue, like in another key. And you hear the rhythm section just kind of bend with him. Like, I'm talking about, like, I'm remembering it and I'm getting goosebumps. You probably can't see all the way here, but I mean, it was total mayhem. And I was just freaking out. I was like, this is so killing, you know?
Lefebvre would describe that same moment in an interview he did alongside Mondo for Premier Guitar Magazine as being given 8 bars just to rage. The raging bars are the moment when the hectic texture gathers its energy and focuses itself like a colossal laser. From this point, the music terrorizes with surges of complex virtuoso drumming and intense guitar atmospherics overdubbed by Mondo using his Lexicon LXP1 reverb half rack with the mix dial to 100%, which he said makes this giant wash of sound and makes whatever note you play sound really good. Bowie's stretched out vocal rides the storm, recalling the drama of similar moments where he holds constant on long notes that sail over the top of quick-paced chaos. I need you flying. Sue has the hectic energies and intense more is more textures of Earthling and the genesis of that sound, the outside. Chaos is where creativity happens, and it is the reality of our existence.
In rehearsal for a new tour, Bowie also has a new album that's based on his new book. This time around, Bowie is deep in dangerous territory for an artist in the late 90s. This new project is all about sex, violence, and death.
The idea that there are absolutes, there's an absolute church, an absolute art system, an absolute politic, doesn't seem to make any sense now. As we pull back the covers of our reality and find that, in fact, indeed, chaos is a far more accurate picture of what we are and how we live than all those defined ideas of this is the right way and this is the wrong way. Those things seem so impractical and something that actually doesn't describe our situation. So it really puts the artist in another place.
There was a lot of ambient noise as well in there, yeah?
Yeah.
Leave that in this time.